more, that should be more strange for you, that should be more special for
you. It's
not father and mother.
It's strange.
For a mother to become a human being.
It's not strange, because remember,
that's the big miracle.
Yeah, it's not strange, because in the Bible, the way it's explained and the way things are happening with Jesus is different to the way it happens. Like, with Jesus, I told you already, it says in the Bible, Jesus sends prophets and messengers. According to Muslims, God sends prophets and messengers. So if Jesus is sending the prophets and messengers, that's, in the Bible, that's basically saying he's God.
What message?
He sends the prophets and messengers.
What's the message?
When someone, like the main message will be said many times throughout scripture. For example, it's many times. Having found message of prophet of God, whatever. God is the creator, this is whatever. Why is Jesus so clear? Why is the normal
way to say I am God? He doesn't say he's a prophet.
He
doesn't
say he's a
prophet. So what, the point is irrelevant.
But I'm trying to prove to you.
But that's my point.
That Jesus never created
the whole book. Did he say he was a prophet?
He never said he was God.
Did he say he was a prophet?
All I'm saying is right now.
But Jesus said also, I'm the beginning and the end. How does that mean? Again, I'm the beginning and the end. That's the same.
Why is there nowhere where it's clear? This is such a detrimental thing.
Right now, this is my point. Bro, when Jesus was saying that he was God, what happened? Exactly.
That's why, listen, let me tell you why.
This is why he couldn't do that from the beginning, because obviously, if he said that from the very beginning, listen guys, I'm God's worshiping, that's arrogant. People would have wanted to kill him straight away. His message would have gone across. He wouldn't have been able to do the things he had to do. So he had to do things in a certain stage. Now, when he got to the nitty-gritty, when he killed him, that doesn't make sense. Because when he got to the nitty-gritty, that's the reason why the Jews wanted him dead. It was that, you think you're God?
What?
So God would have used a carpenter, son.
He could have said it before that. He could have said, I am God. You don't know even need to
do that. I did the Jews when he's dead. You already know. Because he claimed he's God. That's simple. So he must have been saying something for them to think that.
No, but they could have just thought he's a false prophet.
No, we didn't think he was a false prophet.
No, we believe that the Jews believe.
You'd be looking like, all right then. Do you see what I'm saying? So that's my point. That's the point I was getting at. So I said that's the reason why when people are saying that they expect Jesus to come at the very beginning in the scripture, they want him to come and say, it's like Jesus says, they want Jesus to come in the Bible and say, listen, God, guys, I'm God, worship me. And then they would accept God. But I'm saying, why would he believe that?
But the thing is, not really, it's the same way, even atheists, not really, but 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 even athe
losing
survival
is not
fair.
Isa,
remember we had a disagreement.
Who said the prophecy and the message?
I'm saying we had this disagreement.
But Isa,
let's not try and simplify. Let's not try and simplify.
What message?
Let's not try and simplify.
Who said it? What message?
In Islam, yeah, only Allah sends messages.
For us,
but the prophets, yeah, speak. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam recites the Quran, yeah, he is speaking with the authority of Allah. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam brought the verse to his people, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ, and we did not create mankind, and it's not him that created mankind, right? It's Allah, and he is present. But the point is, when you're saying, yeah, Jesus said, I sent messages. My point to you was to say, yeah, that Jesus is speaking on behalf of the Creator, not on behalf of himself.
He started saying that as a vessel. Like, so he's saying in the Quran, right, when Muhammad said, we did not create, blah, blah, blah. It's not Muhammad saying that, but it's Allah.
Muhammad.
So you're trying to say Christ is
doing
the same. That's what I'm trying to make.
I know.
Yeah, that's what you believe.
No,
it's the same.
Bro, no, that's what I
asked.
That's what I'm saying. Do you know why?
Why? Listen, why are you arguing on the point of Christianity?
No.
I want to know what you're about. Because
we want to know. And then we can debate what they want.
The reason why.
Jesus, do you believe him?
Let me clarify the reason why my question is.
If you know it's true, you're going to be the first to believe.
I'm glad you said that. I'm glad.
Let me clarify why I say that.
You keep saying he's God,
for the past maybe a month,
so you are the first
we've been
one
chatting,
who
yeah? And you have been like the staunchest advocate, yeah, for Christianity, even though me and you both know you're not Christian at heart. And it's like you're trying to be the savior.
No.
For Christians.
That's what you're seeing inside yourself. So you're seeing that. No, but that's fine. But that means...
Let me clarify now.
You know why it's a good point that you said that. And that means something inside you then, for whatever questions and things that I'm bringing towards you, is projecting that thought on you about me.
Yeah.
But my thing is this. The reason why I'm actually speaking about it, because you actually said, I've been in this park how many times? I mean, same debates is going back and forth. I listen to both sides of the arguments, both sides of the fence. I look at what the Quran saying, and I know what the Quran saying, because I hear Muslims saying, this is the truth, it's not corrupt, it's perfect. So when I hear what the Muslims are saying, I understand. Now, I have to look at the Christian point of view, where Muslims are saying that's corrupt and wrong. But then on the other hand, I hear Muslims saying it's corrupt and wrong, but then they will use verses from the Bible to prove their points. Which I'm getting confused.
For the Christians.
Hold on, wait.
For the Christians.
Let me finish. All right. They will use bits in the Bible to prove it, to prove that the Bible is wrong, but then also to prove things in the Quran. So, but I'm like, listen, if you're saying that the books are corrupt, yeah? Leave the corrupted book. You don't need that to prove it, because you've got the Quran, that's true. Leave the Bible then. Stop talking about it.
Yeah, but now you're using the Bible.
No, listen.
Let me come back and get done, yeah?
So what I'm trying to say is, where I've seen that, and the arguments that the cases that they put up against, I've literally gone and took the time out to actually look in the Bible and say, bro, let me see what they're saying. When I actually look into the scriptures now, and I see most of the arguments that come up week in, week out, I'm actually like, hold on a minute. But what they're saying is actually here. I can see the point that they're getting to. So when I come in and I speak to certain brothers, I don't say, why don't you guys read Christianity? I just mainly just ask the question, why is it that you read so-and-so? Because I think this scripture says this. That's the only thing.
Generally, in my conversations with our Christians as well, I do the same thing.
Yeah.
The reason why I'm asking you that is, the way you come across is that you're trying to represent me. I just want to understand, like, what is it you're trying to reconcile between what the accusation is? Why don't you talk to one of them and say, well, you see that this Muslim put the question to you like this, yeah? This is my understanding. Does that reconcile with what you're on? And then get them to come forward.
I'm glad you said this. And this is another reason why I did it, because also being in the fucking listening around, load of Christians, yeah, that literally don't know their scriptures. And I've said time and time again to people here, I speak to them quietly, they will just tell me. I speak to them because I'm saying, listen, you see the verse, you know about this. And they're like, no, you know what, I've not even seen it. Some of the stuff that I'm talking about, people come to me and like, I've never even seen these verses in the Bible before. You understand? So the reason why I do this is so Christians can also get understanding as well as Muslims. Point is for both sides to get to some sort of common ground, yeah, whereas you're just not arguing the same nonsense every week.
Because every week it's Muslim saying Jesus not God, this was not God, Allah that this, Muhammad says this. Bro, at the end of the day, try and find out things that make sense and talk about and discuss it. You understand? Instead of like you know what people do, shouting and screaming at each other, the same thing. Speaking, we have years ago.
Let me just ask a question. Like he said the thing about Jesus sending prophets and mendic messages, and you didn't want to answer. But
life is bad.
Okay. But then, this is what I know. If they believe the Bible is corrupt, but let's just say that Jesus is a statement that Jesus is God. So if you don't believe in the Bible, why is it so hard to accept that's what the Bible says? Because you don't, you believe it's corrupted anyway.
But we don't believe that's what it says.
No,
we don't. We look at the corpus. Yeah, of what is the Judeo-biblical text, yeah, and we see this like inconsistency at the end, where all the prophets before come together with a consistent message and a way. They've got the Torah amongst them and the laws. Follow the laws, follow the prophets. Then you lot come at the end and say, no, you can't give any redemption. You're all destined to hell, yeah, unless Jesus Christ dies for you. And then it's like.
I'm saying why?
And I'm saying it's because of inconsistency, or what we see as inconsistency in the book. Further, our book tells us that's a lie.
It's not really inconsistency. Yeah. You know why? Hold on.
You know why? Because you don't see it as
such.
I'm saying we do.
You know what I'm saying? Why then? It would be inconsistency if now Jesus was saying he's never just a human being, man, not God.
Thank you.
Because if he's saying that he's God, it's not inconsistent, it's still going hand in hand.
It's inconsistent because, listen, the reason why it's inconsistent is because, the sunnah, as it were, the way of God, amongst the prophets, is to send prophets from Israel to Israel, not to send himself to them. That's the means. And then you further say, that no one prior to that, could have got redemption without the spilling of blood. Right? That means everyone that came before you is doomed. So what did all the prophets do before then? What did Abraham, what was the point of Moses coming? What was the point of Abraham coming to the people? What was the point of Melchizedek and Daniel and Isaac? And what was the point here?
Before we get to that point, my point was this, because you went a bit off topic. My point was this: Muslims accuse the Bible of being corrupted.
Bro,
right? Wait, let me make my point.
You're going off here.
Let me just make my point. So my thing is this, and this is what I always confuses me when I come to the park: that if the Bible is corrupted, when you corrupt something, you corrupt it to what you believe in. So if the Christians believe Jesus was God, they're going to corrupt the book to make it align with their belief, right? You wouldn't corrupt it to say something other than what you believe. So then if you're trying to say,
we have examples.
Yes, but as you said, Christ said, I sent the prophets. Everyone knows that's a quality of God. So then that would have to be a corruption. But then he'll try and argue, no. But then, if you believe the book is corrupt...
Don't put words in my mouth, because I'm not arguing that.
Yeah, but you can respond afterwards. All I'm just making my statement. If I'm misrepresenting what you say, then you can clarify. But I'm saying what I hear in the book is that if someone corrupts something, you always corrupt it to what you believe and support what you believe. So then when Christians are arguing that the Bible proves that Jesus is God, and they're trying to argue that the Bible says Jesus isn't God, then why is the book corrupted? What was the point of them corrupting the book? You understand? What passages are you putting in that doesn't make sense? Because if you corrupt it, you corrupt it to what you believe. So I have no problem if a Muslim said, I believe the Bible does say Christ is God, but I don't believe in the Bible. You understand? That makes more sense than to say, Bible doesn't make
more
sense.
It's more suitable for us to say that. Because then, when other Christians are listening to us, they feel a complete divide. But it isn't one. That's where it is. Yeah. When we come to Christians and we talk, we're talking from an angle, of taking from the same pool of prophets, taking from the same pool of scripture. Our models of the God that we create are not the same, but they are similar and they're drawn from the same root. So for us to come and say, no, we don't believe in some of the things when Allah says, you have to believe in the Torah that he sent, and you have to believe that he sent the Injil, then that would be kufr. That would be disbelief. That would be disbelief on behalf of... No, because Allah has already said straight.
Right.
You don't believe
so
it.
So Allah,
bro, there are so many angles you can approach the point of corruption from.
Yeah.
There are so many angles. You yourself said, yeah, that if you believe something, you corrupt it, but you corrupt it to what you... Right.
Like Shia and what do you call it? Like, for example, Shias don't believe in a lot of the Sunni hadith because they believe it was corrupted to support the Sunni view. You understand? So that's my example of that when people say...
Sorry.
The Sunnis and Shias.
What's that? Like, believing in each other's hadith.
Yeah. Like, Shias... Yeah. Why?
Yeah, but there's some
because
Shias...
Because Shias hadith to support what they believe, like the Imamas, Ali, and whatnot.
Well, they believe in our hadith when they think it supports them.
So, and what you're doing with the Bible.
No, it's not what... See, there's a clear instruction from the Quran, yeah? And it's the first that I was looking at. And it's mentioned so many times, so I don't know why people are confused about it. Allah says that the Quran is a Muhammad, yeah? And he tells the people, judge by that which Allah has said, right? So the Quran, yeah, is the criterion of what is right going forward. Whatever corroborates the Quran, we will take and demonstrate it to you and say, this is why we believe what we believe, right? You can agree or you can disagree, bro. It's down to you, but don't say to me, for example, if I say to you, yeah, the Shema Israel, yeah, don't say, oh, but you don't believe in the Bible. No, but that corresponds, that message of Tawheed in your book corresponds with what Allah already said in his book, that when it comes to Bani Israel, he says that I'm your Lord, worship me.
But then there's also the verses though where doesn't Allah mention that if the Muslims have some issue in the text, go back to revert to the people of the book.
Do you know the verse?
Yeah, I don't know.
No. There's a verse where Allah says, and if you are in doubt about what we have said down to you, yeah, then ask the people of the reminder. The reminder would have been the Zabur or whatever scripture came before. Right. Ask the people of the reminder. That's what the verse says. If you have any doubt about what has been sent to you, O Muhammad. Yeah, so it's sent out. It's a verse that is cast to the Prophet.
Okay, so the verse that's sent to the Prophet.
You're doing too much brainwork, bro.
Bro, you know me. I have to understand things because if I don't understand, I don't want to leave here saying I didn't get it. So a verse was sent from God to the Prophet saying, if you have any doubt in this verse, go to the people.
No, if you have any doubt in anything that we have sent.
Anything that we sent. Yes.
So,
this is better than most, like, screaming and shouting.
I still don't understand the corruption thing, like.
Bro, really you don't, innit? Like, to be honest, yeah, I wouldn't even be having this conversation if it's not for you. Like, I personally don't think I can get anything from you in the conversation. I'll be real with you, bro. I believe, yeah, you understand the arguments quite lucidly, but you're stuck. But and I don't blame you. You've got your conviction in being a Christian. So as far as me and you, there's an impasse. There's not much benefit I can get from you. From you, I just wanted to understand what is it, why you've got this new vigor for the book. Is it just for the
written solution? Yeah, it's more for clarification and for more understanding. Do you understand? That's what it's more for. And people misleading certain things from the book when it says certain things that we're talking about, the main part. But get to that verse.
And then the thing for me is I'm trying to understand the criteria of corruption, and that's where we're at the impasse. For example, like Muslims will say Muhammad is in the book of Isaiah. Now, Isaiah is not listed as a prophet in the Quran. So what was your criteria to... Because that book could be a whole corrupted book. But because you're saying that because we like the sound of it, we're going to say this is about Muhammad. But that's like when he brought up about the Shias, he said what they pick what they like and reject what they don't like. So now you have to demonstrate to me you're not doing the same thing.
Because Isaiah is not listed as a prophet.
So how can they say Muhammad is an Isaiah when Isaiah is never listed as a prophet? Right.
But what does Allah say about prophets in the Quran? Has Allah listed every prophet in the Quran?
No.
Right.
So then that would mean.
So then you cannot
affirm that this is Muhammad because you don't even know if Isaiah was not a madman or something. Because if the Bible is corrupted,
okay,
even if it's a mad criteria to determine what is authentic or not.
Yeah.
But then you'll say, no, this is Muhammad. But how do you know? You don't even know who Isaiah was.
Because we say it because it corroborates what's in the Quran. Like I've said, the Quran is the criteria. But the Quran is the Muhammad. That's what I've said.
Yeah, but then if Muhammad never ever told anyone, because the Quran says,
I'm not saying this, listen,
actually, no, no. Even the Quran says Muhammad was mentioned in the Torah, which was given to Moses, and the Injil. Isaiah wasn't given to Moses. So then what is your criteria to say Isaiah was mentioned in Muhammad? Because it only says the Torah and the Injil.
From what I understand, the Torah is in the Quran is utilized generally for Tanakh. Anything that came to the prophets of Bani Israel, anything that came between Musa and Isa, was referred to as the Torah, except the Zabur, the Psalms, which has its own whatever. And then you have the songs of Ibrahim as well and other stuff. But the verse you refer to, yeah, about ask the people, yeah. So it says, the verse says, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِكَ إِلَّا رِجَالًا نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. And we have not said before you, except men. That was the point that I was trying to make, that Allah said men, and then all of a sudden he came in and stepped in himself. That's the inconsistency. We have not said except before you, except men, and we inspired them, نُوحِي إِلَيْهِمْ. فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ ذِكْرِ إِنْ كُنْتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Ask the people of the reminder if you do not know. Right? So here is a thing to go to the people of the reminder, i.e. the books that came put and inquire.
What translation is that though?
This is the Arabic reading.
Yeah, but which one? Because Sahih, doesn't that one say the book?
Yeah.
So what's the difference between what you said and the book?
Right, so I'm reading Ahl al-Dhikr, the people of the reminder, not the book. There is no reference, there's no verse that says go to the book.
So what's the people of the reminder?
So the people of the reminder would be a synonymous term, yeah, with the people that received the scriptures before you, which would be the people of the book.
It's the same thing.
Yeah, but listen to the context.
Okay.
We have not sent before you, yeah, men. Or we have not said before you except men. So I mean, we've only said men before you, right? That we inspired. Ask the people of the reminder. Ask the people who read the books. Ask the people who read the Torah and the Injil. Did they get sent angels or did they get sent men? That's what it's asking.
And he reads the Torah as a Christian. He reads the Torah in the Old Testament.
What you're saying about
he might do, but I've not known Christians to really do that. To be honest, I feel like Christians miss big chunks out of the Torah. And they say it's not relevant to them because they have a new covenant. So there's not really. Yeah.
And what you're saying with that verse, what does that go with to do with the Christian
badge? Because you asked me about is there not a thing to go back and ask them?
Yeah.
And I'm saying to them, no, there's a context, right? And the context is in regards to this specific question. But the point, which is poignant, is the fact that I'm saying to you, only men came. That's why I'm saying it's inconsistent.
But Jesus is a man, only, angel.
Is Jesus a man?
Bruv, I believe Jesus is a man. But I was taught as a Catholic, yeah, that Jesus is 100% man and 100% God.
Catholics.
I don't know if any other Christians say anything different than that.
Okay. But it still goes to the point that when he says he sent men, that's fine. Jesus was a man.
Yes, okay. Jesus was. So I'm saying the message of the Quran is that only men preceded you. The message of the Bible is that men and then a God preceded you.
God in man.
I think that's just semantic. Because it's God. At the end of the day, whether it's God in man or God in his full glory, it's still God.
Let me ask you a question. I understand what the Muslims are saying with their point. Because I've spoken to you, people like you and that have heard other Muslims, I get your point. I get what you're saying. Because obviously in your text, that obviously you believe that is perfect and sent from the Creator, the last final message. It says Allah sends his message via angels and obviously prophets.
Yeah.
Yeah? that's fine. Allah doesn't come down into the creation. Yeah. Oh, actually, we had that discussion last time. So you don't know now.
Let's not get into the stickiness of that. That's all philosophical.
I know what you're saying, but then this is why, that philosophical bit is a bit where it goes into it with the Christian. Let me just mention that as a Muslim,
I might get flat for it, but I don't really care. As a Muslim, I'm not saying Allah doesn't do this or he can't do that. I say what the people say is la yambari. It's not befitting for him to do such.
Okay.
Right. So when I'm saying,
let me just make
a clarification. I would have, and I think I've said this to you before. I would have less of an issue with Christians if they said that Jesus, the body, was just I don't want to make it mundane, but just a meat suit.
Yeah.
That inside that thing, hosted God with all his full power, glory, I'm saying, I'm not saying it is.
Yeah.
That's, see what she said? I said that to you last time. He emptied himself. I'm saying to you, how? The all-powerful creator, all-wise, almighty creator of all creation, relinquished his knowledge. Relinquished all his power. Come on, mate. You said he emptied himself.
No, you said he emptied himself. Not fully. He emptied himself lesser than the angels. In the gospel, he speaks, he knows things that other people don't know. He didn't lessen himself to the point of humanity. That would be ridiculous. He made himself lesser than the angels. He made himself. He laid down his life and he can raise it up again.
He never emptied himself to a man. That means a man didn't. The blood sacrifice is not valid because you don't have a man. You don't have a man.
You do.
You don't. You just.
All men are lesser than angels.
You contradicted yourself.
Yeah, but what she's saying, like you, bro, you as a human, you have a human body, flesh, but you have a soul.
I know that, bro. Right. That's not the point. If we're saying that, then Jesus is not distinct from any of us. He's a human being.
I'm using language,
and I can only express it from the way I understand. And I feel like when I'm talking to people that subscribe to the Trinitarian, I feel like sometimes we're using language differently. So even though we're both speaking English, our comprehension is different.
Yeah, but that's with any type of conversations anyway.
But let me get you an understanding from what she was saying. When God said,
this is my bone I'm picking with.
No.
You feel that you can explain more than she can as a person who holds that belief.
No. It's not even explain more. That's what I said. Let me give you my understanding. That's why I didn't say I know more.
Okay.
I was saying, let me give you my understanding from what I know. From what she was basically trying to explain.
Yeah.
From what I've read in the text, I'm looking at it now, it seems that Jesus is saying, God is saying that he's taking the form of a human being, son of man, which is the chief of all men. That's why he's saying, these are my flock. Mankind is his flock, he's the mother hen. Yeah? He's lessened himself to the angel, but he's still above man.
He's still
a man above men, though.
That's fine.
Right.
But then,
I don't have an issue with that.
Yeah. So now, what you were saying earlier about if Christians were saying that God had the flesh,
So he retains all of his knowledge and whatever.
Yeah.
He just came through in a looking like a man.
Yeah.
Which is in his power to do. He just came through looking like a man. Rolling, but he's still essentially, for all intents and purposes, he still retains his power, his knowledge, whatever, and it's not even really him. Maybe it's his essence is controlled.
Well, he doesn't retain all his power though, because in heaven you have the Father, and then he's the Son, so it gets even more complicated.
No, it doesn't get complicated. It's just remember, no one can understand what God can do. We're thinking of human beings trying to understand how he can be there, up there, at the same time. But remember, that's God. You can't try to understand what he's doing.
No, but that's not God. Both of them are God.
But like I said, that's in his... He can do what he wants.
Yeah.
We can't comprehend him. We're human beings.
100.
We're limited.
100. So that's the point.
Let me get back to this point. What I'm trying to say is, he did still keep some, like you said, he did keep some of that God edited. He had it because he understood of the unseen. He knew of the unseen.
But he didn't know it completely though.
But he did speak of some bits of the unseen.
Yeah, but so did the prophets. The prophets before him did the same thing.
But he spoke of the unseen.
Moses spoke of the unseen. Moses didn't prophesy to his people what's going to happen to what's going to come to pass. Moses came back to his people angry. Why did he come back to his people angry? When Moses went to the mountain and they started worshiping calves, why did Moses come back to them angry?
No, because
God had informed him of what happened. God had informed him of the unseen, not that he automatically perceived that people had worshiped calves.
But this is the difference. God had informed him. Remember, God was having.
That's my whole point.
No, wait. The difference is God. Jesus was an informer.
I'm saying
but the scripture doesn't say that. This is what I'm saying. In the scripture, when Jesus talked about the unseen, it's live. Him talking, telling you, listen,
claimed that he got it from himself though?
Yeah, bro, he's telling you. He's talking to the disciples saying, at this very minute, someone is betraying me. No one knew what was going on. They were like,
you're saying that necessitates that he never got that knowledge from God.
But we have to see where he got that knowledge from.
I'm saying prophets are always getting revealed to all the time. They're not saying, now I'm getting revelation.
If you say that's revelation from God, I'm just saying, I'm going by what he's saying. If he's saying to the people he's talking to right then, they're saying, you guys stand up right now. There's a person right now who's betraying me right this moment. The disciples are like, what's going on? Who's betraying you right now? How do you know that? And then next minute, not even that, right, minutes, so the people come and betray man.
Right, so when he says, how do you know that? He said, I'm God, that's why I know that.
He didn't have to say that.
Wait, what do you mean he didn't have to say that? Why would they ask questions then?
Now, this is my point. It's like,
it's weird, bro. I don't,
joy is,
okay.
From what I know, it just seems like Muslims want a clear, precise thing to say where Jesus is literally saying, I'm God, worship me, and that's it.
Bro, I'm saying the prophets come with clear examples. They don't come ambiguously.
Yeah, but that's how
they don't come ambiguously,
with,
bro.
Yeah, but that's why.
Did he say
that? Did Jesus say he was a prophet?
I don't. In the Bible, yeah, but in the Quran, it says I'm a messenger.
Right.
It says that in any of our
sources. Yeah, never said he's a prophet. But that's what I'm saying. Christ.
People ever refer to him as a prophet?
Yeah, but Christ is the only person.
People never refer to Christ as a prophet.
Yeah. But Christ is the only person. Did he ever say parables as well? Other prophets didn't really come with parables. Like even like Jesus' whole thing. Not to the extent that Christ did. Everything a lot of things he did was parables that confused a lot of people. And
his parables meant to teach the people lessons, not confuse them.
Yeah, that's the thing. But watch this. Let me ask you a question. This is how I think I understand that there's definitely a difference between who Jesus is and the rest of the prophets. None of the messages of prophets.
Do you actually believe that?
No. I'm going to say from the text. You already know. This is from the text.
All right, cool.
So from the text, out of all the prophets that I've seen, pertaining to the Bible, if you're saying he's a prophet, let's just go by you saying that he's a prophet.
I'm saying he's a prophet.
Out of all the prophets and messages in there, he's the only one, for some reason, that can be seen saying him and the Father share the same knowledge. Him and the Father are one. Not only that, he commands his angels. He has angels, bro, that he commands. He's the one that's sitting on a throne next to God. Not only that, he's sitting next to God. He was saying that he was there before the foundation of the earth.
Before Abraham was.
There's another verse as well where he's actually saying Jesus was there. He was there with him before the foundation of the earth was created. Yeah. Not only that, he's got his kingdom. So of all the prophets,
all that makes him a special, bro.
But let me just add to what you said.
All that makes him special.
Let me just recite.
Solomon had an empire and a kingdom that no other prophet had.
Let me just read you something from the Bible before I bounce anyway. And this is a parable from Christ, related to everything. Yeah. It says, listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard. He put a wall around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he rented the vineyard to some farmers and moved to another place. When the harvest time approached, he sent his servants to collect his fruit. The tenants seized his servants. They beat one, killed another, and stoned a third. Then he sent other servants to them more than the first time, and the tenants treated them the same way. Last of all, he sent his son to them. They will respect my son, he said. But when the tenants saw the son, they said to each other, this is the heir. Come, let's kill him and take his inheritance. So they took him and threw him out of the vineyard and killed him. Therefore, when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? He will bring those wretches to a wretched end, they replied, and he will rent the vineyard to other tenants, whom he will give him his share of the crop of the harvest time. Jesus said to them, have you never read in the scriptures, the stone that the builders rejected has become the cornerstone, and the Lord has done this, and it is marvelous in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you that the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people who will produce its fruits. Anyone who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces. Anyone who on whom it falls will be crushed. When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard Jesus' parable, they knew he was talking about them. So now, this is clearly saying that you have the owner of the vineyard and he's sending people. These people that are being sent are prophets, because he said the Pharisees were the people that were killing the servants.
Yeah, the messages.
And, that's the, and he said, Jesus says that. Exactly. But then he said, the owner sent his son. So from this parable, what is Christ saying? Because he said the son was the heir to all the inheritance. So what? And he's distinguishing between the son and the prophets. You understand? So even looking at this parable.
Where's the distinction between the sons and the prophets?
Because he's saying the owner was sending the servants, and they kept killing the servants. Then the son, then the father said, I'm going to send my son, they will respect this person. But then they killed the son. But then he's saying the Pharisees are the ones that were killing the servants, because they killed Christ as well. So if Christ is saying he's identifying as that son in the parable, and there's a father.
That's why, do you know why that's funny that you did that? Go to Matthew 23. This is, and this is why I give this point here, because I didn't even, what parable was that from? Was that
from? That's Matthew 21.
Yeah, go to Matthew 23.
And I'll now read. Therefore, indeed, I send you prophets, wise men, and scribes. Some of them you will kill and crucify, and some of them you will scourge in your synagogues and persecute you from the city, that you may come all the right, that on you may come all the righteous blood shed on the earth, from the blood of the righteous Abel to the blood of Zechariah, son of Berechiah, whom you murdered between the temple and the altar. Assuredly, I say to you, all these things will come upon this generation.
This is him.
Woe to the scribes and the Pharisees.
So this is, and the reason why this is funny, because that goes with that parable that we were talking about, where God was saying to the Pharisees and the scribes that he's sending the servants, and many of them you'll kill. And this is what Jesus was saying. Jesus is saying, I sent the prophets and the messengers, and many of them you killed. So this is again alluding to that same thing where he's saying, in it, it's like he's saying he's God, and this is the reason why he's now the son. Do you get my point?
Yeah. It's illusion, and that's what I'm saying. Like,
what's that verse though, that where he asked one of the disciples, who am I? Who did they say I am?
The Christ, the Son of the Blessed One.
I don't know.
And that's for me, if you say you don't believe the Bible, fine, but it's very clear in terms of what, like, how Christ is laying out things, and that's why you have to look at a lot of scripture, because he says he'll tell people things, but they won't understand it. Like, certain people will, but others won't. And he'll speak in parables to confuse a lot of people.
The most important thing now is, Lisa, are you convinced from what you've heard?
I believe the Bible says that, but he doesn't believe in the Bible, like I said from the start, that's what I'm cool with.
I'm not even necessarily convinced that parable has to take that reading.
But if he's saying that,
I'm not convinced. Yeah, this parable of the son coming and then saying, like, there's so many. There's like technical. I don't even want to go into it.
But who's the owner? Who's sending the people? Who the son is and who the servants are? And what? And once you kind of answer that question, you'll get your.
That's the thing. But in order, to get that question, if you want to get that answer, who gives the answer? Is it the Pharisees or is it Christ?
Well, I need you not to discuss it.
No idea. Bro, do you know what it is?
bro, I've been coming to here since 05. I'm tired. I'm exhausted. I've made peace with the fact that my mind and my brain is never ever going to see it the way they do.